So now we see the sulfuric acid as an oxidizing agent. So sulfuric acid is a strong oxidizing agent. See, we know the oxidation involves the addition of oxygen or removal of hydrogen. So the oxidizing property of concentrated sulfuric acid is due to the fact that H2SO4 or thermal decomposition yields nascent oxygen, okay, which helps oxidation. So nascent oxygen oxidizes non-metals, metals, inorganic compounds, and oxidation of copper. For example, oxidation of copper. So this is what happens, that if we take sulfuric acid, now I told you earlier that H2SO4 Cu is a CuO or something is able to react with H2SO4. This is mainly because the Cu cannot displace hydrogen, but here the main thing is because of the formation of the oxide, which is going to be, the nascent oxygen, that nascent oxygen is helping the copper to react over there, and hence it is able to give the reaction with copper. So we see that first of all, what is causing the oxidation to take place is H2SO4, if you heat it, it decomposes, and it gives you, under decomposition, it is going to give me H2O plus SO2 plus nascent oxygen. So this nascent oxygen is the one which is going to be the key of any reaction to take place. So if this comes in contact with copper, so copper, when it comes in contact with this nascent oxygen, automatically it is going to give rise to CuO, because it is very simple that it can stick, this thing is going to stick to anything which is available to it. And then the CuO is going to react with H2SO4 further, and it is going to give rise to CuSO4 plus H2O. Okay, so we can see the resultant of all these three equations will be here. CuO, which was formed, is going to be cancelled over here. So we see that Cu, when it reacts with H2SO4, which was over here, it is going to give me, what is the resultant over here? It is giving me CuSO4 plus water, and SO2 is going to be given out. So this is the reaction that is going to take place. So that's why we see that sulfuric acid, concentrated sulfuric acid, is a very good oxidizing agent because of the formation of the oxygen, nascent oxygen formed during decomposition of H2SO4. So accordingly, we see that due to this particular property of formation of oxides by sulfuric acid, it is reacting with both metals as well as non-metals, and on reacting with metals and non-metals, it gives you the resultant oxide of the non-metal plus water plus sulfur dioxide. So every time you can see, sulfur dioxide is going to be give the result. So metal ho ya non-metal, metal and non-metal, when it reacts with sulfuric acid, it will give you some kind of a salt or maybe a acid, a gas over here, plus water plus sulfur dioxide. So this part is going to be very common in each and every case. So let's see the reactions over here of sulfuric acid with first non-metals and then metals. So with non-metals, we see, let's say first is carbon. So carbon plus H2SO4. So as I told you, it is going to give me CO2 plus H2O plus SO2. So this is the reaction what I'm going to get. With carbon, it is going to give me a carbon dioxide plus water plus SO2. If it is a sulfur, then sulfur plus H2SO4 is going to give me, because sulfur dioxide already mili raha, so it is going to be SO2 plus H2O only. So because it's already available over there, so it will be, of course, it will be 2 and 3 over here, and in the first case it is 2 and 2 SO2 over here, right? In case, yeah, of course, this is concentrated, so it is conch. For with phosphorus also, so 2P plus 2H2SO4, so 5H2SO4 is going to give me, again here it is going to form into phosphoric acid plus H2O plus SO2. Okay, so 2 and 5 as the balancing. Similarly, if I am having metals now, so if I am taking a metal, the metal like copper is going to give you Cu plus 2H2SO4 is going to give me CuSO4 plus H2O plus SO2. You can see the reactions, they are very, very similar to the ones which were there in nitric acid, because nitric acid is also a very good oxidizing agent. It also gives you a nascent oxygen. That's why there also, every time when you are taking that particular concentrated acid, you are getting NO2, here you are getting SO2. See, if you remember such kind of the relationship between the two chapters, you will find that learning the equations becomes very easy. Otherwise, you learn this separately and learn that separately and do not connect it, then you will have to learn each and everything. Like, you will have around 200 different equations to be learned from the whole book. Okay, so to cut down on what you need to learn, you can easily formulate this thing that the reactions of metals and non-metals of concentrated acid of nitric and sulfuric are the same. Only thing is, nitric will give you NO2 and sulfuric will give you SO2. Clear? Right, so next is Zn. So Zn will be reacting with H2SO4 concentrated again to give you ZnSO4 plus H2O plus SO2. The balancing will be again 2H2O in both the cases. Right, so this was about the metals and non-metals. Now we also see some inorganic compounds. So in inorganic compounds, so inorganic compounds, may we are taking over here hydrogen iodide, or we are taking over here hydrogen sulfide. So if we are taking a compound that is 2Hi plus H2SO4 concentrated, we are going to get iodine as an outcome, plus water plus SO2. Of course, these two will be common. So SO2 will be formed over here. Similarly, if I take over here H2S plus H2SO4, then H2S plus HO4 will give you sulfur plus 2H2O plus SO2. So every time you are getting water plus sulfur dioxide from a concentrated sulfuric acid. It depends upon what you are taking here, you are getting this particular thing. If you are taking hydrogen sulfide, you get a sulfur. If you get hydrogen iodide, you get iodine. Okay, that was for inorganic substances. Hydrogen iodine can be oxidized to iodine, and hydrogen sulfide gas oxidized to sulfur. Now we see the next part of the chapter, that is sulfuric acid, concentrated sulfuric acid as a strong dehydrating agent. Now you can see that hydrogen concentrated sulfuric acid is playing a multiple roles. Okay, it is a non-volatile acid, so it is used to give volatile acids. It is a very good oxidizing agent, that's why it is used to give you sulfur dioxide and such kind of reactions. And thirdly, it is a dehydrating agent. What is a dehydrating agent? It is having a very strong affinity to water, towards water, that it can absorb, or we can take out the water molecules even if they are a part and parcel of a compound. And hence we see concentrated sulfuric acid removes elements of water due to its strong affinity to water, for water. That is, hydrogen plus oxygen in the ratio 2:1 from carbohydrates, organic compounds, etc. And hence it is used as a dehydrating agent. So normally, see, if something is just removing the moisture from somewhere, it is very common. It's just a drying agent. But here it is a dehydrating agent. Means a carbohydrate which has got the water molecules in it, you know, the HNO are in the ratio of 2:1. In that case, that water molecule will be removed by sulfuric acid because of its very, very high affinity towards water. Hence, we see that sulfuric acid is a very, very good strong dehydrating agent. Concentrated sulfuric acid also removes water of crystallization from hydrated salts. Concentrated sulfuric acid also acts as a drying agent. It dries gases such as nitrogen, oxygen, chlorine, sulfur dioxide, and HCl. H2S and ammonia react with H2SO4 and hence not dried with concentrated sulfuric acid. Drying agents bring about a physical change with no change in the composition of a compound, whereas dehydrating agents bring about chemical change and a change in the composition of the compound. Accordingly, what we see over here is if we take glucose, so if we take glucose, that is C6H12O6, and you react it with H2SO4, you will find that it will give you over here 6C plus 6H2O. So here you can also write directly on the arrow that H2SO4 concentrated added to it. So when you bring concentrated sulfuric acid close to the glucose, it is going to give you carbon plus water. Cane sugar is C12H22O11. This is cane sugar. Okay, this is glucose. This is cane sugar. Again, the reaction is the same thing. It is going to give me 12C plus 12, 11H2O. Any cellulose also will give you the same thing, which is not required. Wood or paper. Wood or paper will also give you the same thing. That is C6H10O5 into N will also give you 6CN plus 5H2ON. So this is because multiple forms are there, but anyway, you are not required to learn this for equations. Similarly, over here, formic acid and oxalic acid, ethanol, they are also going to react with the sulfuric acid. So these reactions will again be repeated in the chapter organic chemistry. So just go through it. Formic acid is H.COOH, that is methanoic acid or formic acid. When it reacts with H2SO4 concentrated, it is going to give me CO plus H2O. Similarly, that is oxalic acid, that is COOH, single bond COOH. This you need not consider, ye abhi samajhne ka zarurat nahi hai. We are going to understand this thing when we are learning the organic chemistry part. So you can just note this thing as COOH, single bond COOH. Is going to give you again CO plus CO2 plus H2O, and ethanol, that is C2H5OH, is going to give me as C2H4 plus H2O. So these are the reactions with ethanol. And finally is that CuSO4.5H2O in presence of H2SO4 is going to give you CuSO4 plus 5H2O. So the water of distillation is going to be lost. So this is blue in color, blue crystalline is going to turn into white amorphous. So that is what we are having over here in the last part, hydrated salt. So you see, observation wise, you can have two things in the observation. First observation is when you are taking crystals of sugar and you are adding the sulfuric acid to it, there is going to be a black spongy mass of charcoal, so of carbon, not charcoal, of charred sugar, that is coal, that is carbon. So when you are going to take some sugar and you are going to add sulfuric acid to it, it is going to give you a black spongy mass of carbon. So observation with black spongy mass of carbon form, and steam is seen to be evolved. So that is what you see in case of the observation when you have the concentrated sulfuric acid as a dehydrating agent. Another observation will be over here of copper sulfate. Blue copper sulfate crystals are going to turn white amorphous powder when it is coming in contact with, not even contact, but just sulfuric acid is placed near to this particular thing. So that was about the chemical properties of sulfuric acid. We are now going to go through the tests which are going to prove that a particular acid is a sulfuric acid. So first one for the test is for sulfuric acid. So let's see the test of sulfuric acid. These tests are very, very important because they do ask you that how will you identify the two acids when one has got nitric acid and other sulfuric acid, or one is hydrochloric acid and other sulfuric. So kaise usko identify karenge, that is the important part. So here you have the concentrated sulfuric acid addition, action of heat on copper or sodium chloride with concentrated sulfuric acid. So you have got over here first one, Cu plus H2SO4, we know is going to give you CuSO4 plus H2O plus SO2. So this reaction is going to evolve SO2. So the formation of SO2 over here is going to be the cause, because agar ye nitric acid hota, to it would have given you NO2, but here it is SO2. If you'd have been HCl, it would have not reacted at all, because Cu does not react with HCl, because there is no formation of, it's not an oxidizing agent. Second is NaCl. So with NaCl, when it reacting with H2SO4, is going to give me Na2SO4 plus HCl. So HCl gas is going to be evolved. So evolution of HCl gas is going to be identification. Now how do you identify SO4, SO2? SO2 will be identified by, it turns the lime water milky, but even carbon dioxide does that thing. So we can identify it by using acidified potassium dichromate paper or potassium permanganate paper. So if you are taking potassium dichromate or solution, it is going to turn from orange to green. So potassium dichromate turns orange to green. And for HCl, we know that test will be ammonia. You take ammonia, the glass or dipped in ammonium hydroxide, it is going to give you dense white fumes of ammonium chloride. The next one is the test for finding out whether the acid given to us is a dilute H2SO4. So this was for concentrated. This one is of course for conch. Now for dilute. Okay. So for dilute H2SO4, we have got first of all is BaCl2 plus H2SO4 dilute. Gives me over here 2HCl plus BaSO4, which will be a precipitate. Now, same thing, it will be PbNO3 twice plus H2SO4 dilute is going to give me over here 2HNO3 plus PbSO4. We very well know that all sulfates are soluble, but what was the exception? The exception is that the sulfates of barium and that of lead are insoluble. This is the test for sulfuric acid. If I would have used any other acid over here, it would give me barium chloride or barium nitrate according to what I am using here. If it gives me any other thing, it would have been a non-precipitate. It will be a solution over there. But because BaSO4 is going to be formed, this thing is an insoluble salt which is formed, which is a white PPT will be formed. So only PbSO4 and BaSO4 are insoluble in H2SO4 and hence gives white precipitate. PbSO4 is insoluble in hot water and or even in heating. PbCl2, however, is obtained on heating PbNO3, which HCl is soluble in hot water. So yeah, PbCl2 is soluble in is insoluble, but it is soluble in hot water. So here again we can easily differentiate because this is completely insoluble. So to test to distinguish between H2SO4 and HCl and HNO3 will be, you take BaSO4 solution, when added to dilute H2SO4 gives white PPT of BaSO4. But with HCl and HNO3, no PPT is produced since BaCl2 and BaNO3 twice are insoluble, are soluble in H2SO4. So you can see that if I got three jars and I want to identify out of these three which one is sulfuric acid, I am going to take one particular test tube containing solution of BaCl2. So if I take BaCl2, add all the three one by one in three different test tubes, of course. So the one which is giving me the white PPT will be sulfuric acid. Okay. So that was the test for sulfuric acid, very important. The next one are the uses of sulfuric acid. Uses: fertilizers, ammonium sulfate, superphosphate of lime, fibers, dyes, drugs, rayon, nylon, dyes and drugs from coal tar derivatives, explosives, trinitrotoluene and trinitroglycerin, picric acid, acids, volatile, nitric acid, hydrochloric acid and phosphoric acid. Yes, you can produce these acids from sulfuric acid, so it becomes a use. General uses may, oil refining, H2SO4 is used for purification of oil products, for example petrol, because you can use, it's a very good dehydrating agent, so you can purify it this way. Pickling metal, removes metallic impurities, oxide carbonates from the surface of the metal before galvanizing. lead accumulators as is the batteries, the car batteries, what you have, the car batteries has got sulfuric acid in it. So sulfuric, because it's a electrolyte which is used. So sulfuric acid undergoes electrolysis and hence used in storage batteries and preparation of iodine, carbon monoxide, hydrogen, hydrogen sulfide. So these are the different uses of sulfuric acid. So the last part over here is about the reference of oxidation and reduction reactions. So you can see oxidation is addition of oxygen, removal of hydrogen, addition of electronegative elements like chlorine, or removal of electropositive element like potassium, sodium, loss of electrons. All these are oxidizing. So oxidizing was add oxygen, remove hydrogen, add electronegative, remove electropositive. Okay. And finally, it is loss of electrons. So these are the five ways a particular substance can be oxidized. Similarly, reduction is all ulta of that. Reduction is remove oxygen, add hydrogen, remove electronegative, add electropositive, and gain of electrons is that is of the reduction reversion. So reduction involves these parts. So according to you see that HCl, when it reacts with oxidizing agents, they will give you chlorine gas. It's a very important part. So HCl is a reducing agent because it is going to be used with oxidizing agents to give you chlorine gas. So HCl oxidized, consider HCl oxidized by MnO2. So that's why oxidation, that is the removal of hydrogen, is going to take place in case of MnO2 is an oxidizing agent, so removal of O2 is going to take place by HCl. That's why it is going to, the MnO2 is going to get reduced, or we can say HCl is going to help in reduction. Or we can, so that is oxidizing agent again with carbon or sulfur or copper, the nitrate, so nitric acid. The nitric acid is a very good oxidizing agent, so that's why we saw that oxidizing agent, it gives you NO2. Sulfuric acid again is an oxidizing agent because that's the reason it reacts with non-metals to give you SO2. And finally is ammonia is a reducing agent because ammonia has a tendency to reduce the copper or copper oxide to copper. So that's why it is a reducing agent. So we see over here that nitric acid, sulfuric acid are oxidizing agents. Ammonia is reducing agent. Whereas hydrochloric acid or the hydrogen chloride gas is going to be reacting with oxidizing agents to give you chlorine gas. These are the important, some important kind of references which you would require for oxidation reduction. So a substance which undergoes oxidation acts as a reducing agent. So ammonia, which is a reducing agent, itself undergoes oxidation and is oxidized by CuO, by chlorine to nitrogen. And a substance which undergoes reduction acts like an oxidizing agent. So HNO3 is an oxidizing agent, itself undergoes reduction and reduces to a number of reduction products, NO and NO2. Right, so this is about the chapter sulfuric acid. So that was the end of the sulfuric acid and hence the end of the four compounds. So the study of four compounds has been done. So acid based salts ke baad mein, the study of four compounds was connected thing, I suppose. That's why we have taken this thing in one go and we completed this part over here. Okay.